quick and just know that behold how good and pleasant it is for brothers and sisters to dwell together in unity. Psalm 34 says, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Verse 4, for I sought the Lord, he heard me, and he delivered me from all of my fears. Verse 8, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. We ought to enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful and bless his name, for the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. David said, I wouldn't faint. I'm going to keep saying scripture until you all get the spirit this morning. He said, I wouldn't faint it unless I seen the goodness of the Lord while I yet live. Isaiah said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, and I saw him high and lifted up in the train of his robe, filled his temple. All I'm trying to say this morning is that this is the day that the Lord has made. And we ought to rejoice and be glad in it. Will you help us rejoice this morning? Will you magnify the Lord with us this morning? Will you help us exalt his name this morning? Come on, let's clap our hands. Come on, you can rock with us. Come on, come on. Help us say, Lord, you are good and your mercy. Come on, let's go.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
One more time. Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
People from every nation.
People from every nation.
What to say this morning. God is so good, beloved. When I think of what God has done, all I can do is shout. If you got to shout this morning, throw back your hand, wave your hand and say, hallelujah, hallelujah. For this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice. Oh, I'm about to mess up, huh? Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. What a glorious, glorious day. I woke up this morning, and I thought about an old brother that used to open up worship, and he would sing a song, and he would say, Lord have mercy, I'm so caught up, I can't get it out. But he sang a worship song every Sunday morning, and the same song every Sunday morning for years. I look forward to hearing George sing that song. God, man, and I've been singing it all day. But the Spirit just took it away. It's gone. So anyway, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our call to worship, which is printed in your bulletin, let us recite this responsively. Amen. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem.
For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness.
Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house, Lord. I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Altogether,
Oh, sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, and all the earth shall sing his praises. Amen. This morning's hymn of praise is hymn number 84. Hymn number 84. Great is thy faithfulness. Oh God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee that changes not. Thy compassion, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou ever wilt be. Oh, great, great is thy faithfulness. With no further lining.
Come on, let's all sing together. Great,
great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassion
summer and winter,
summer and winter and springtime and harvest,
sun, moon, and stars in their courses above,
join with all.
Church. Pardon for sin.
Pardon for sin.
Strength for the day. And right hope for. Blessings all mine. Come on, one more time. Great is thy faithfulness. Thank you. says, great is
As you take your seat, I'm going to ask you to focus on your morning, the one that allowed you to get here this morning. I don't know what went on in your homes. I don't know what went on in your mind, but today, focus on God and what he's done for you. The song says, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All we have needed, God's hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto all of us. And we're grateful and we're thankful. And God, some of us are sad, and some of us, God, don't know the next, but you didn't set it up that way, so we're grateful. We're grateful for the time that you kept us coming here, the time that you'll send us back home. We're grateful, God, for every breath we take. We're grateful for being here today for the celebration of 13 years as for pastoral ministry for Reverend Dr. Derek Nathan Brown. We're grateful for the mother that held him in his hands like Mary held Jesus. Not that he's the God figure, but he is the man of God that Miss Elaine held in her hands and looked in his eyes and knew that her baby would be great. Great is thy faithfulness. Through all the trials and troubles, she had her mother stand beside her and take care of her two children. Great is thy faithfulness. And then on the day that he met and looked in the eyes of his wife, Lorraine, God, great is thy faithfulness. A man, God, after your own heart. A man that may have fallen sometimes and done some things, God, but you forgave him because he is your friend. Great is thy faithfulness. God, we are here today to celebrate this, to celebrate you, and thank you for rising from the cross so we could have this opportunity. And God, today, 13 years of pastoral ministry, accomplishments, building us, ministry's birth, ministers come into fold. God, great is thy faithfulness. Visiting the sick, God, giving that word that's needed, God, great is thy faithfulness. Oh, God, we thank you. God, we're learning by and by to accept what you allow. And we're going, God, to trust that you know what you're doing in this man's life. And so, God, as he stands today to deliver the word, I ask that you empower him like you've never done before. To allow us to know that his heart is fine and his mind is clear. And that life will be what it is supposed to be in his life. Great is thy faithfulness. He's not leaving us in despair. He's leaving us in victory to go do the next step that God has called him to do. Great is thy faithfulness. And so, God, as we sit here thinking about ourselves, God, I ask that you remove the self out of the equation and know that we will accept what you have allowed, that we will grow, God, based on the seeds that have been planted, that we will cultivate the seeds that he left for us to cultivate, that we will grow in life, God, to be the people that he visioned that this church would be. God, we ask that you bless his wife as a helpmeet, because this is a new journey for her. And strengthen her, God, for whatever you have called her to do. God, great is thy faithfulness. And for each of the people sitting under the sound of my voice, God, you have something special for each one of us. You created us. We are God's masterpieces, created to do your work. And so, God, let us do that. Let us go in glory. Let us shout, God. Let us be excited about our next steps as we've learned to accept what you allow. I lift this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise him. Oh, praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior. Oh, he's worthy to be praised. From the rising, of the till the going down of the same. The name of the Lord is
worthy. Jesus is worthy.
Oh, he's worthy to be praised. Somebody ought to help me praise in the morning, in the noonday, in the midnight hour, praise him. Jesus, Jesus, blessed Savior, blessed Savior. Come on, one more time. Oh, he's worthy to, come on with it, be from the rise, from the blessed Savior, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. It's a celebration this morning. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, nobody greater. Nobody greater, nobody.
everybody. Hey, push them up. Hey, push them up. I'll push them up. I'll push them up. I'll push them up. Hey, push them up. Push them up. Push them up. Say, say, mighty are the works of your hands.
Mighty are the works of your hands.
Say, mighty are the works of your hands.
Mighty are the works of your hands.
Now, come on, come on. Just... I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, uh-huh. Nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, give God some praise. If you haven't found him, he's in the house of the Lord today, amen. Hallelujah. All glory and praise to God. I don't know about you, but I feel good in my sanctified soul. I feel the spirit of the Lord in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are celebrating, but we still have a church. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. All glory, honor to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is my job to bring the welcome this morning. Welcome to New Hope AME Church, where our pastor is the dynamic Reverend Dr. Derek Nathan Brown, and our beautiful First Lady is Lady Lorraine Brown. Yes, we are here to celebrate them 13 years of ministry here at New Hope. Amen. And we give God all honor, glory, and praise for their leadership, for their service, for their prayers, for their love, for their untiring support, not just to the New Hope family, not just to the Charles County community, but to all family and friends here and above. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. If you are worshiping with us for the first time, first look at your neighbor and give them some love, because we tight up in here, but we're going to have a good time. Amen? Have a smile for them. Let them know that it's okay if I bumped you a little bit. Amen? So if you are worshiping with us for the first time, we would ask if you would kindly stand. We do want to acknowledge all of our visitors who are here in the sanctuary, those who are in the chapel, those who are online. We thank you for worshiping with us. We are a church changing lives through the power of God's word. So it is our prayer that you will worship God in the manner that you are accustomed to, feel at home and relaxed here. Amen. 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 Before we got some presentations we're going to do, but before we get started, we do want to acknowledge the Masons of the Beehive Lodge. Yeah. If you can all stand, I know you wanted to process in. We didn't get an opportunity to do that. But if you can all stand, we acknowledge you. We thank you. We thank you for the relationship over the years. And so we are grateful that you are here today. Amen. 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 We have several presentations that we are going to go through as we honor our First Lady and our pastor. Pastor and Lady Lorraine, if you can join us down on the floor here. Amen. Amen. Get your tissues ready, everybody. Amen. We're going to love on our pastor and our First Lady. Amen. It's going to take a little time, so it's going to be all right. Amen. 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 Yes, sir. If you can. Amen. Amen. Our first presentation is our senator, who is also a member here at New Hope, the Honorable Arthur Ellis. He is the senator for District 28. Amen. Amen. And him and Mrs. Ellis, they'll do the mic down there. If you could go to the podium for your presentation, amen.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I said, I miss you all. It's good to be here today. Yes. I almost didn't make it because this is the last few days of our session in Annapolis. And we were working, can you believe it? Politicians working on a Saturday. But we were working yesterday till last night, got back late last night. And my wife, I thank her so much, I had to have her roll me out of bed to be here this morning. So, yeah. And this is my wife, Rosanelle, is here to make a presentation to our pastor and first lady. So this church is very instrumental in the community, very community conscious. And if you look in your program, the page pictures, you'll see Pastor Brown in Annapolis. The first picture to the left and the one to the right. The pastor's there with the governor, the former Senate president, the former governor, and the current Speaker of the House, in this picture right here, Adrienne Jones, the first African-American, the first female Speaker of the House of Amen. Delegates in Maryland.
Amen.
And she's also a member of this denomination, by the way. So the pastor was there, and there is a number on the in front of the speaker. It says SB 512. That's my very first bill I passed in Annapolis, my very first year, protecting our Maryland residents who are federal workers, protecting them from government shutdown, federal government shutdown. This bill says if you, and it's now law, by the way, if you are a federal government worker and you don't get paid because of government shutdown, you don't have to worry about paying your mortgage, you don't have to worry about paying your electric bill, your telephone bill, you have to worry about paying your rent, all that by law, you can go on vacation, all right? You don't have to worry about anything. And this church and Pastor Brown, Mr. Brown, was instrumental in us getting this bill passed because we had a town hall meeting during that terrible government shutdown in 2018, early 2019, right here in the church. It was well attended, and we spoke to you, the members, and the community, and see what needs to be done. And I went back to Annapolis, and we put this bill in. It became law, and now you are protected. So I thank you, Pastor, for your leadership, not just for this church, but for this community and for the state of Maryland.
Amen.
Very much instrumental in us getting things done. I could go through so many other things, but I know other folks who want to honor you also, so I'll end there. So thank you so much. And so on behalf of the state of Maryland, I have a proclamation. It says the Maryland General Assembly official citation, and this is what it looks like. And I just want to say, let me read it to you. Be it hereby known to all that sincere congratulations are offered to Reverend Dr. Derek Nathan Brown, in recognition of your 25 years of ministry. So you were a minister before you came to this church, right? Yeah, my staff did the research. And provided the community with a spiritual home. Thank you for being such a great example of living a life of faith. Presented on this 7th day of April, 2024, by your Senator, Arthur Ellis, Charles County Legislative District 28. And let me present this to Pastor Brown. learned a thing or two being married over 30 years. I'm not going to just recognize Pastor Brown and that remember the First Lady here, because I see all the work and trials and being away and serving the community that my wife goes through, and I know you go through similar things as far as we serve, the support, the help, directly and indirectly. So on behalf of the Maryland General Assembly, I will not shortchange you, First Lady. I'll read your citation. Official citation be hereby known to all, and this is what it looked like. Be hereby known to all that sincerest congratulations are offered to Lady Lorraine Brown in recognition of, yeah, my staff did the research on you also, your 25 years of ministry and providing the community with a spiritual home. Thank you for being such a great example of living a life of faith. Presented on the 7th day of April, 2024, by Senator, your Senator, Arthur Ellis, of Charles County, District 28. That's my wife that presented to you. Okay, thank you, Senator.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Senator Ellis and Mrs. Ellis. We appreciate your presence being here. Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. And our next presenter is the Honorable Reuben Collins, the president of Charles County Board of Commissions. He is a friend of us, so welcome our Charles County Commissioner President, Reuben Collins.
So I knew Senator Ellis would outdo me with this, so. But y'all gotta understand, originally, because of travel, because my wife and I and my daughter were in Colorado Springs the last couple of days, and I didn't expect to be here. We were there to celebrate a very special event in my son's life. He pledged Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. And of course, Pops had to be there. Because, you know, I did that a few years ago, prior. So I wasn't able to bring to the table the type of recognition. But I'm going to do the best with what I have. And what I'd like to really express is the appreciation that I've established through the years, through this outstanding ministry, and actually prior to Pastor being here, the commitment that my family has had to this church. This church has been a leader in our community for decades. I can recall vividly presentations in this church focusing on housing, focusing on food insecurity, focusing on educating our residents to what the most important issues were of the day. And so for me, it's an easy lift to be a part of any type of appreciation for a powerful ministry such as this. But it gets a little deeper for me and a little personal, because I can tell you, during the course of one of the most difficult times of my life, this church embraced me. I will never forget that as long as I live. And Pastor, you were there. That's why I can tell you this is my brother. I love this church. I love you guys, because what you're about is what true ministry is as it relates to any community. The church is the community. And this church embodies that. And so for me, it's very personal to be here today. First Lady, Doc, on behalf of the County Commissioners of Charles County, I'd like to present this official citation. And it's funny, because you know, you go through these appreciations and these kind of things through the years. And you know, in many of them, the vibe that you receive, it's almost like the people are just ready for you to kind of move on, you know? But I'm not feeling that at all.
Take your time, brother. Take your time.
I'm not feeling that at all. What I'm feeling is a sincere appreciation of a man and woman of God who have committed themselves to the people. And so be it hereby known to all that sincerest congratulations are offered to Reverend Dr. Derek N. Brown, pastor, in recognition of 13 years of guidance and service with New Hope African Methodist Episcopal Church. The Charles County Commissioners extend their sincerest appreciation for your service to the community and congratulations on your retirement. The County Commissioners honor your devotion and commitment to the residents of Charles County, presented on the 7th day of April 2024 by the entire Board of Commissioners. Reuben Collins, President. The Vice President is Ralph Patterson. Representing District 1, Gilbert Bowling. Representing District 2, Thomasina Coates. And representing District 3, Amanda Stewart. Now, it says here that you're retiring. Now, I don't think that's quite accurate. Right. And I was talking to my brother here. I was like, now, okay, what is this really about? And so I got schooled. I know you got much more to offer to this community. But we're here now to show our love and appreciation for you, man. God bless you, man.
Amen. We thank you, Commissioner Collins. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We two in and a few to go. Amen. Amen. Our next presenter is Mrs. Orlena Watley. She is the principal at General Smallwood Middle School. She was the former principal at Dr. Mudd, our partner school, and we also partner where she is now. She has been a pillar and a partner with us here at New Hope and will continue to be. We will have her come forth. Following Mrs. Watley, we will have a presenter by the Beehive Mason Lodge.
I'm sitting here and I'm just in awe and appreciative to be able to just come and say some words on behalf of Dr. Mudd and General Smallwood, but also for me, just the relationship that I've built with you over the years. I sit here and I'm thinking, how did I get to come behind Senator Ellis and Mr. Collins? I'm like, Reverend Eubanks? I should have, you know, but I was like, that's a tough act to follow. But I want to speak, you know how you always have prepared notes and you always want to also, the authentic me wants to first say that words that resonate with me are impactful. Community consciousness, as Senator Ellis mentioned, and just the love for what you do. And doing it with a godly heart and a godly spirit. I remember, and I'll be very honest, there are many churches who come to us every day or throughout the year that says, we want to partner with you. They show up, and they show up one time. And not that we look down on that or we frown upon that, because all partnerships are meaningful. But when I spoke to Pastor Brown and First Lady Lorraine, they said, this is not a one time. And I said, people are of many words. I'm about action. And he'll tell you I said it. And I want you to know that Your actions spoke louder than words. To see the consistency, to see that they were there with me. They worked with me through COVID, through the pandemic, serving families every day, coming every day, bringing things, things that I didn't even ask for because they knew there was a need. I deviated from my speech, but I just wanted you to know you all mean a lot to me, and you don't have to see people or speak to people all the time to let them know that they mean something to you and that their presence are imprinted in your heart. I don't have to see them every day, but when Pastor Eubanks asked me to come and give words, absolutely, because I want to give people flowers while they're here. I want to be able to share that while I can. While she didn't give me a time limit, I brought notes, and I do want to share what you all have meant. And as I did move over to General Smallwood, I remember calling a few weeks ago. I think I sent the text and said, do I still have any favors? Because he never turns his back. She never turns her back on giving back. And it speaks to it's a testament to this church. When they come, you come. And when you come with a spirit that resonates within our schools, within our communities, and it's instilled in us. So I want to first give honor to God, who was the head of my life, and I also want to thank the New Hope AME Church for this opportunity to speak. In Hebrews 13 and 16, it says, and do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. In the New Testament, God himself gave us his only son, because he loves us so much. And that son died on the cross for us. It sets a model that generosity in God's people should be sacrificial. We all know that every action we take impacts the lives of others around us. The question is, are you aware of your impact? As a former principal of Dr. Mudd Elementary School, I understood the need to build partnerships with organizations based on the needs of my school and the students we serve. As the largest Title I school in Charles County, the impact that stemmed from your vision, Reverend Dr. Brown and First Lady Lorraine, has left a lasting imprint on my students, the staff, and the families in our school community. I remember receiving a call from Pastor Brown asking, what can we do to support your school? I reflected on those words because in his work and in this work, we have seen it all. When people or groups understand the magnitude of the work, partnerships fade. I remember Pastor Brown saying, this is a commitment. I stand by my words. I reluctantly said, sure, okay, let's see what we can do. We have been let down before, but that didn't waver because support is support and we need it for our students. Others did not understand the time commitment or the ongoing needs of students in a Title I school, but God. Pastor Brown looked at me and he said, okay, don't believe me. I said, I will focus on your actions, not your words. Well, let me tell you, the actions of New Hope, the First Lady, Reverend Doctor, left me speechless. And if you know me, that is saying a lot. Pastor Brown and First Lady Lorraine had a vision for this partnership that I have found that when one creates a compelling vision, it becomes the first step in changing any aspect of one's life and others. Your vision laid the groundwork for the partnership that developed between New Hope AME and Dr. Mudd Elementary School, and it has extended on to General Smallwood. I am a firm believer that God places people in positions of leadership for a reason. Through your leadership and vision to serve and give back, our Dr. Mudd students, staff, and parents learned and saw firsthand how our village grew and became blessed because of the New Hope Church, AME Church, and the vision and dedication of Pastor Brown and First Lady Lorraine. New Hope's partnership strengthened and enriched our lives. While the adage states that it takes a village to raise a child, well, Pastor and First Lady, you took it a step further. In addition to being a part of that village, you helped extend the adage by saying, we are here and we're going nowhere. Your active participation in our village gave our students and our families and our communities a newfound hope that there were people out there that believed in us. It went beyond the internal and extended to the external. That a church, our church had found us and said, we are here for whatever it was you need. There was nothing small and nothing too big that you all did not deliver on. So your vision of a true partnership has left an impact on our school that can never be erased. So let's take a look at that, and I promise I'll be quick. When the pandemic hit, New Hope delivered necessary PPE for the staff, students, and parents. When shelves were empty of necessities such as paper towels, Lysol wipes, gloves, face masks, we had an abundance because of you. Each week, our families had hot meals, fresh produce, milk, non-perishable items for their homes. We had many families who were wage earners that were furloughed. Thus, food was a dire necessity. But God, I remember a parent getting out of their car and Pastor Brown praying for health and strength and guidance and telling them that it's going to be okay. I remember us holding prayer circles in the parking lot with parents who just needed to know that someone was there for them. But God, the New Hope family came and embraced our parents. They were a constant weekly that they came in droves just to hear and see that someone had faith that today was going to be a brighter day. That even through it all, turmoil was only there for yet a little while. That they had someone in the church and someone in the community who was there, who could uplift us, who could pray for us, and who could say, God will never leave your side. We also had Christmas at Mud, which was a huge success. We served families who were struggling from month to make ends meet. New Hope not only provided gifts, they served meals and they prayed with families. See, that's the piece that I enjoy. I know we have separation of church and school, but when we have these opportunities, we ask. And I will tell you, 100% of the time, parents want that. They need that. I see it. I need it. It's a struggle. Prayer keeps us uplifted. It keeps us grounded and rooted in the work that we do so that when others see that we are living by those convictions, they have hope. I want to instill in my students what you instilled in all the ones that you serve, that hope that there is a brighter future, there's a brighter tomorrow, there's going to be a brighter day. So our families had an opportunity to go through the holidays with their children with their dignity intact. And every year when we scrambled to ensure our students who needed backpacks and who needed supplies had what they needed, we made just a phone call. I'm sorry. They called me. And they said, where do we deliver? So under your leadership, boxes and boxes of backpacks and school supplies were delivered to the school. Every student who had a need had a backpack, had supplies. And I remember Pastor Brown and First Lady reaching out and just saying, what else can we do? What else does your New Hope AME family, what can we do? So New Hope's presence was a signature of your leadership and vision to strengthen the footprint of the church and the communities you serve. Leadership is about making others better as a result of your presence and making sure that impact lasts in your absence. While you have served with grace in class, your leadership has been superb. And I am honored that I had the fortunate opportunity for our paths to cross. The impact of our partnership reminds us all that visions without actions is merely a dream. Actions without vision passes time. Vision with action changes the world. Amen. Reverend Dr. Brown, First Lady Lorraine, your vision has changed lives for the better. That's the impact of who you are as a person and your leadership. And on behalf of Dr. Mudd, General Smallwood, myself, I want to just say thank you for believing in our school and believing in strengthening our village through your vision and true partnership. Thank you, and I love you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Our next speaker, amen.
when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Now, this is my first time here, but I walked in and I felt that spirit.
Amen.
And, you know, I felt like Shouting John when he just said, can you hold my mule? You know, my name is John R. Countryman Jr. I'm the worshipful master over at Beehive Lodge number 66, but the whole District 9 came, Pastor. So we have four lodges in District 9 under the leadership of my worshipful Rodney H., our district deputy grand master over there. But we just wanted to come and show some love on today.
Amen.
You know, Pastor Brown has come to Beehive a few times to speak to us at our spiritual feast, at our Martin Luther King Jr. celebration. And the thing that I found out about this man is that although he was not in church, he brought the church with him. This brother got up and he started speaking and jumped up on our tables. And the Spirit of God was just all upon his face. And I believe those that were sitting in the audience that may not have been in a spiritual frame of mind, that when Pastor Brown got up and he finished, they were in a spiritual frame of mind. Brother, we just love you. I feel privileged that I can be the one that stand up and speak on. Brothers, can you just stand up and show your love? All Masons in the house. All Masons in the house. Member of Beehive up in the choir stand, doing what he does. But Pastor Brown, you know, I don't have that eloquent speech like the rest of them do, but I just want to say thank you. And from my breast pocket to your breast pocket.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. I am standing reading a letter on behalf of our Honorable Sheriff Troy Berry. Sheriff Berry could not be here today. I spoke with him on last week. He had sent his regrets because he had a family trip already planned. And he said, please extend my love to Lady Lorraine and Pastor Brown. He said, I can't be there, but I want you to read this letter on my behalf. Let them know that I love them and that I will connect with them before the week is out or when he returns, that he could not be here. So I lift this letter up on his behalf. It reads, Dear Reverend Dr. Derrick Brown and Lady Lorraine Brown, I truly appreciate New Hope AME Church's invitation to take part in the special recognition of your service to the church and the Charles County community. As much as I would like to attend, I will be out of town for a family event. However, I do want to pass these few words on to you. It is with admiration that I acknowledge the 13 years of service you have dedicated to New Hope AME Church and Charles County in your desire to meet the spiritual and physical needs of the community. You deserve much applause for your work. I am grateful for the numerous opportunities I have had to collaborate with New Hope Church on community events such as National Night Out and Christmas Winter Wonderland. These special events reassured our citizens of the churches and law enforcement's ongoing commitment to community service. I also take this time to express my appreciation for your past graciousness in inviting me to deliver a message of hope to the New Hope congregation. I will long remember the warm welcome I receive. My thoughts and prayers are with Lady Lorraine Brown as you begin this new chapter in life and ministry. Be aware of your compassionate nature, your strong faith, and your wealth for experience. There is no doubt in my mind that you will be an inspiration to others in whatever capacity you serve. Please know that I consider you a peer in the community, a brother in faith, Pastor Brown, and most importantly, a friend. You have my best wishes as you continue to work and uplift others. The Church of Jesus Christ is not a denomination. The church is not a building. And the church is not a position. The Holy Scripture reminds us to acknowledge one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, because the church is within us. God bless you, Lady Lorraine Brown and Reverend Dr. Derek Brown, signed by Troy D. Berry, Sheriff of Charles County, Maryland. Amen. Amen. Our next presenters, and we ask that you would please keep your comments to 2 minutes. We are got to move quickly. We next have Mr. Arthur Graves. He is a member in an emeritus stewardship and finance head here at New Hope, followed by a presentation by Gifted Ladies of Worship, Reverend Jacqueline Roots, the ministry head, followed by Brother Rodney King, the president of the Mighty Kings of New Hope. Amen.
It's an honor to give some remarks regarding the dear loved Pastor Brown as he embarks on a new chapter. I want to express my deep, deep gratitude for his dedication, service, and spiritual guidance. I also want to thank the First Lady for her grace, her love, her generosity, and her support to the other Brown family members. We thank you for your support, and we will always love you. I want to share with you two remarkable accomplishments this great man has made to this church that has been critical to its survival. The first one is how the membership and Sunday attendance have grown expeditiously. In 2011, when the pastor was assigned, at his first sermon, there was approximately 30 to 40 worshipers in attendance. Following this service, we were in his office, and he said to me, he said, "Art, I can see the vision." And my response to him was, "Amen," because I couldn't see it. But today I can, and I have been able to see it over the last months. This morning, or some people, he's going to, if he hasn't already done it, he's going to stand before you, and he's going to take a picture with his camera of this congregation. And what he's going to see is that the chapel is overflowing. And that was the vision that he saw in 2012. And Pastor Dutch, you know, Proverbs, the 29th chapter, teaches that where there is no vision, the people perish. The second accomplishment goes back again to 2011. He met with the stewards the Thursday after preaching his first sermon. And we provided him with the financial health of the church. We were enslaved to a mortgage of over $500,000 with a double digit interest rate. The next meeting, with the stewards, he came with a flyer that read debt reduction. He said to us that God had told him that New Hope needs to be debt free. And on Sunday, he was going to ask the church to donate what they could over their tithes to this campaign. He said, I want you to continue paying the mortgage as you have been each month. But I want you to pay directly on the principal, the contribution made by the congregation to the debt reduction campaign. And he said, I want you to put my monthly salary directly on that principal. Pastor Brown did not accept a salary until this mortgage was paid off. He is a great leader, and because of his exceptional leadership, the congregation did its part, and we paid off the mortgage in approximately 5 years. In summary, I just want to say that Pastor Brown was appointed in 2011, and we were enslaved to a mortgage. But after his sermon today, the church would have been debt-free for over 3 years. And the membership and attendance have increased expeditiously. These are the facts of what this great preacher has accomplished while as our pastor. And as I previously stated, these accomplishments have been crucial and essential to the survival of New Hope. So glory to the God. And thank you, Pastor Brown.
It was going to take me 2 minutes to get here. Pastor and First Lady, I'm grateful. I am grateful that you gave me the appointment. I'm grateful that you saw us in the market in Philadelphia and invited us to come. And so I stand here today because we're honoring, as well as you, we thank you, but we're honoring this woman of God. My dedication scripture to her is this, and it has always been Ephesians 2:10. And I'm changing it for her. For she is God's masterpiece. He has created her anew by Christ Jesus so she can do the good things he planned for her long ago. You are grace. You're God's anointed, God's masterpiece. You are God's righteousness and God's royalty. Anointed, confident, and encouraging. For each of you, you all have a story. And my story is that my children have been prayed for by this woman. When my son wasn't available for us, her prayers dried my tears. When my grand jewel got alopecia and lost every bit of her hair and her eyebrows and her eyelashes, she came to this church during the furlough to give away, and she poured into that child, and she still talks about the lady that's the pastor's lady, not the pastor's wife, the pastor's lady. And so if all the women of GLOW, please stand. That's the Gifted Ladies of Worship at New Hope African Methodist Episcopal Church. Please stand. These are your sisters. These are the ones that pray for you. These are the ones that you've prayed for. And when I got my assignment and they had an event, and she said, and I said, oh, that's nice. Who's the speaker? She said, you. I said, oh, okay. But she's encouraged me. She's loved me. And I can't say that for everybody, but I can say it for her because she means what she says and she does what she says. So on behalf of the women, you should come get this because it's heavy. These are our gifts to you for the self-care of love that you've given us. Take care of yourself. I'm not going anywhere. I will find you, and I'll love on you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Rodney Kaiser. I know they said King, but thank you. I know what you was thinking. A King. So thank you for that. Pastor Brown, First Lady, just on behalf of the Mighty Kings of New Hope, as their president, we just want to thank you for the love and the vision that you've given us and have you embraced us. I didn't prepare any notes, but I looked down at the program, and that was all the note that I needed. And it's just a church changing lives through the power of God's word. So as a personal testimony, when I was coming here to New Hope, I attended with my lovely wife, Debbie. And when I say I attended, I was sitting there waiting to get to the NFL games, right, and sat in the back. And then Pastor Brown showed up. And I started listening. Then I seen him walking on the pews. And I'm like, wait a minute, what's going on? And it caught my attention. And I could truly say that my life was changed because I started getting involved. And one of the things, I didn't come to church for a couple of Sundays. Knocking on the door, they said, Pastor is here to see you. I'm like, what do you mean, Pastor is here to see me? And he came with Gerald, and they was like, hey, we worried about you, brother. We ain't see you in a couple of Sundays. I called home, back home in New York, and I go, this pastor came to my house, man. Can you believe this? And the thing about it is just no judgment because, you know, a lot of rough edges I had. And I was apprehensive about going to the first men's retreat. And I remember that and how it impacted me. And then several years later, I organized the men's retreat. You know? Praise God. Wow. So just briefly, once again, I just want to say a church changing the lives through the power of God's word. And God's word through Pastor Brown and the love through Lady Lorraine embraced us. And when I started, I say my son joined, my daughter joined, my youngest son was baptized here, and the family was changed and transformed through my leadership, but following that leadership. And God be the glory. One last thing, what I really appreciate is no judgment when I spoke with Pastor Brown. And like I say, some rough edges, that's between us. But I just say I love him. I love his family. I love First Lady. And we just have a little token from us, right, on behalf of the man. And, you know, did a lot of movie watching. So, you know, that's just part of it right here.
Amen. Cassandra, can you? Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And amen.
Amen.
We halfway through, y'all. Almost there. Praise the Lord. Our next presenter is Sister Gail Radcliffe for the Missionary Society, followed by our YPD, Sister Carlicia and Cameron Ben. Amen.
Good morning, church. First Lady. It's my honor to be standing here beside our First Lady and President of the Hazel Clemencia Missionary Society. Would all former members and current members of the society stand? All former and current members of the Missionary Society, please stand. First Lady, we present this to you for your commitment, your love, and your leadership to our society and keeping us connected to the area, to the district, to the conference, and to the connectional missionary societies. Please know that our heart goes out to you, for we know that you have a big heart for missions, and we thank you for that. We thank you for the love that you've shown unto us. We also thank you for the beauty on the outside and the beauty that's on the inside, for your heart is big, and we so much appreciate it. We pray that as you move forward, that you will continue to stand tall, height and heart, for what God sends your way. And before we close, oh yeah, I didn't give her this. This is all for you. Don't need no husband to hold on to it for. And before I close, as you come to the end of the chapter here at New Hope AME Church, and you start the new chapter, I would like for each of you who's here in the congregation today to share a word of love, affection, for all that she means to you. Now, when I say share a word, at the count of three, and I'm going to count three, I want you to shout it out. So as she moves forward, she'll never forget what New Hope AME Church, what she means to New Hope AME Church. Whatever word, so she'll remember, whatever time of day or night, we love you. We care about you, and you'll always be in our heart. One, two, three. Love! God bless you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm a little nervous, so bear with me. Okay. So I want to start off by saying, one day, 10 years ago, when me and my family were in AT&T, we were getting our phones together, and we were being helped by Brother Kip. And he was talking to my mom about this church called New Hope AME that we just had to attend. Within our first two visits at the church, we all joined the church, me and my family. When we first came to this church, I was 9 years old, and now I am 19. I remember when me and my sister joined this church on the New Year's Eve countdown service. At the time, I'm gonna be honest, church was something I more so had to attend, but I didn't know back then what an impact it would have on me forever. Through the ministry at this church, being the YPD youth conferences, the Easter plays, the vacation Bible schools, and the children takeover services, I have become not only a better person, but I feel like a better Christian. Thank you. The way you all have continued to impact and pour into the youth of this church is just unforgettable. Now that, even so, I'm in college now, whenever I come home, I always make it my mission to come back to church or watch online. I feel like church has become something that I went from having to attend to wanting to attend. My relationship with God has grown so much over these years, and that all started with this church, and I love everybody at this church because of it. I just want to say that I feel like not everywhere can say that they take the opportunity to make sure their children are as kept as the adults, because church was made fun here for me. Over the years, it was just all the activities we got to do and the people I got to meet that just made church fun. So thank you again. I just want to say, in this next chapter of your life, may God continue to guide your path as you continue, and be blessed. Thank you.
All right. I won't take up too much of your time. Good morning, Pastor Brown, First Lady Lorraine, and my New Hope family. 2 weeks ago, Pastor Brown announced his retirement, and I didn't know what to say. Then they asked me to make remarks, and I still didn't know what to say. So naturally, when I don't know my next steps, I just look to God and see what he wants me to say. And he brought me to Philippians chapter 2, verse 1 to 4. It says, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interest, but each of you to the interest of others. I joined this church when I was 15 years old, and over the last 10 years, I've had such great memories with you as my pastor. From the road trip to the Young People's Department Conference, going to the movies, Easter programs, multiple graduations, birthdays, and of course, the times he fed us all, good times we ate, we did. On behalf of all the young people, we thank you, Pastor Brown, and your beautiful family for being proactive and taking interest in us young people of this church to help us build our own relationship with God. Because how many pastors do you know will walk the pews just to make it a point that nothing nor no one can come between you and your relationship with Christ? I could go on and on, but I'll leave you with this. Just like Barack Obama will be my forever president, in my heart, you will be my forever pastor. God bless you and this next chapter in your life. I love y'all so much.
Praise the Lord. Y'all give our young people a hand clap of praise. Amen. One of our other young people, Brother Adrian, could not be here, but he wrote a letter that he wanted lifted up. And it says, I've been going to New Hope ever since me and my family moved here around 2016. Ever since then, Pastor Brown has been nothing but supportive, loving, and caring. He's truly one of the best pastors to exist. He is engaging with his community and makes everyone feel loved. Having him as my pastor and Lady Lorraine was really the best thing ever. He made sure to get the kids involved and heard. Nothing can replace the influence he has had on me because he is one of the most genuine people I know. Something in me recently told me I should start going to church more often. This was just God's way of telling me that something was about to change. I can't imagine anyone else but Pastor Brown at New Hope, but wherever he is, I will follow. Amen. It won't be the same hearing your name announced at every service, but in my heart, you will always be there. Thank you both for everything and what's more to come. I love you, and I thank God for bringing you into my life. That was from Brother Adrian. Amen. Amen. And we're going to move real quickly. We have two final presentations. Brother Alfred and Sister Lorraine Bennett is coming, followed by a presentation by the steward board.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
First, let me just say before he starts, it's an honor to be able to stand here and just say a few words from our heart for you guys. You just have no idea how much we love you. We're going to miss you. Go ahead.
Good morning. To New Hope, family and friends, to Pastor Brown and First Lady. We relocated here in 2018 from New York. And our pastor gave us a church maybe about 40 minutes from our home where we were going to be living. And we said, it got to be a church closer than that. So then we came, we found, my wife Googled it, but we found New Hope. We came here in January of 2019. After we came in, we felt the love because everybody greets you with love and new hope. And we saw the pastor came out, and then he brought the word. I mean, he brought the word. And all of a sudden, he came down, and we looked, we said, what's going on? And he started walking the pew. We said, wow, that's cool, you know? Then after that, we said, well, we stopped looking. After 9 months, we said, well, this could be our church. We joined the church after 9 months. And we just want to say that, Pastor Brown, you're not only my pastor, you are a true friend. And the good thing about it, he's from Charleston, South Carolina, that's where I'm from. So that's my homeboy. And First Lady, you're the best of the best. I just love the couple that you are. And may God continue to bless you, whatever you decide to do after this.
And so I just wanted to throw some thank yous out because I've been at AME all my life, and there are not any, I'm not going to say many, but any AME pastors that I have run across like you. And so that was another reason I said, this man is the real deal. He is a genuine man. We listened to your Bible studies. You had so much energy. And so I just want to take a minute because I've never had this before. So I wanted to say thank you, Pastor and First, for not only being great leaders, but being great friends. For your call, when I was in the hospital, pastor never called me before when I was in the hospital. hospital. When I was in the hospital with COVID, you called me to check on me. I looked and said, I can't believe this man is calling me to check on me and pray with me. So I want to say thank you. I don't forget those things.
And he gave my mother a big smile on her face on her 92nd birthday this year. He sent her a bunch of flowers, something that she had never gotten from anybody.
No pastor has done that before. Our daughter and son-in-law have a t-shirt business. We just happened to mention to him. He supported that. He calls out our baby in prayer all the time. We stopped one day and told him we won't be in church because we're traveling. He took us to the corner and prayed with us right then and there for safe travels. First Lady, I sit in a choir and I watch you sitting here, and I see the love and support you give your husband every Sunday and your beautiful smile. Thank you both for being so generous and coming up with Give Me My Flowers, which we both was honored. They came up with that idea once a month to honor seniors. Who does that? I mean, it's just amazing, and they are amazing. And then the Winter Wonderland, your idea to bless over 100 children. It just blows my mind. So for allowing New Hope to hang out with you at the movies, I ain't never had a pastor to take the congregation to the movies. Not once, but twice. Never had that before. To Grandma and to your beautiful daughters, they give the best hugs in the world, like they've known us for years. I'm going to miss that as well. Finally, thank you for always making he and I and my entire family feel special, including my daughter and my son-in-law, Charles Hamlin. Thank you. Ecclesiastes 3 says, for everything there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven. We know this is God's will. Even though I don't want you to go, we know this is God's will. We know he has something up his sleeve just for you guys. And it will be amazing, because that's exactly what you deserve. Amazing. You are unique in everything you do. Please don't ever change, because you are magnetic and people can receive what you have to offer. Wait, one more thing. I saved your last robocall because I want to go back and listen to you saying, what's up, New Hope? This is your boy, Pastor Brown. I greet you with the love of Jesus. I saved that in my... Okay. Yep. We love you so much, Pastor Brown, and first, and we'll miss you dearly.
Praise the Lord. Brother Kip, would you do us a favor, please, and bring Grandma up? For those of you who don't know, this is Grandma Jerry. She is all of our grandmothers.
this is a bittersweet moment for New Hope. Words cannot capture adequately how we feel about you, Grandma Jerry, Pastor Brown, and Lady Lorraine. You came to this church and you gave of yourselves unselfishly. You gave your time, you gave your attention, you cried with us, you prayed with us, you had discussions with us, some heated, some not, but they had to be done. You loved up on us, and we appreciate you all for this. You've been to graduations, baptisms, weddings, funerals. You've done it all. But that's what family does for one another. That's what true family does for one another. You support one another. You love one another. You might not like each other all the time, but you support and you love one another. Let us not forget that. Love up on one another as much as you can while you can. We want you to know, Grandma Jerry, that you hold a special place in each of our hearts. From the moment that you hit that door, she is talking and loving up on people and calling people's names loudly across the sanctuary. And we appreciate you for everything that you do, for every shimmy, every shake. We love you. And this is a token of our appreciation to you, of our love for you. We are grateful for you, and we ask that God continually bless you. We would like to present to you this gift and plaque. Yes, for you. She said, oh, for me. Pastor Brown, Lady Lorraine, would you come forward? We cannot tell you how much you mean to us. You've touched each and every one of us. You loved up on us. You taught us. You broke bread with us. You took us to the movies. You all know he walks the pews. You've been with us every step of the way. And like I said, you gave of yourselves unselfishly in every way that you could, in every way that you knew how to. Your leadership has set the bar very high. We appreciate you. We love you. Pastor, you preached a sermon on the seasons and how it's necessary for them to come and go. Change is necessary. You said it's because we have to grow and we have to transition. So we know that this is growth and this is transition for you. This is not a goodbye. This is not a goodbye because we know we're gonna see you again. You are obedient to God's will and we know that he has so much more in store for you. So we would like to present to you this plaque, Pastor Brown, and it says, celebrating 13 years, Reverend Dr. Derek Nathan Brown, pastor, with heartfelt thanks, we honor you today for your faithful and dedicated service to our Savior and mission. Stand firm, always give. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Lady Lorraine, this is for you. this plaque is yet a token of our love and appreciation for you. And it says, Lady Lorraine Brown, we celebrate your dedicated service for 13 years. We love you and we thank you.
We have a token of our appreciation also. We know you love going to plays, and you know Pastor Love sitting up front, he will be seeing the Michael Jackson play. We want to bless First Lady so that she can just take time to pamper herself, because they've been so loving to all of us.
I'm sorry, we wanted to ask for the New Hope family if you would please stand. Pastor Brown. From the New Hope family, Lady Lorraine. From the New Hope family to the New Hope family, we love you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We just have one more presentation before you. I'm sorry. One more, just as the last one. It was not part of the program. But please have a seat just for two more minutes. I promise you it's going to be quick. Pastor Brown, as your daughters in ministry, there's just two of us here at New Hope. Sister Kay, if you would please stand. And myself. I accepted my call to ministry under Pastor Brown's leadership. And we both have grown through his teaching, through his preaching, through his guidance, through his vision, through Lady Lorraine's prayers, through your talks, through your words of encouragement. And so as your daughters in ministry, we say, we love you. And I'm so grateful that on this Friday, my pastor, who will still be my pastor, will get to lay his hands on me as I'm ordained as an elder. And I give God glory. I give God glory for how you poured into my life and my family. So the ministerial staff, please stand. We thank you for your leadership. We thank you for your guidance. We thank you for your vision. And from New Hope, this is a letter to you. New Hope members, please stand. Your New Hope AME church family and friends would like to take this opportunity to thank our Almighty God for sending us a servant leader like you. It is very rare to find a pastor and a first lady who stands firm in their faith and consistently loves on the people of God with sincere dedication and support. We wanted to express our deepest gratitude for your 13 years of dedicated prayers, faithfulness, and spiritual guidance. We thank God for sending us such a remarkable pastor and first lady. Since you joined us 13 years ago, we have grown and matured spiritually. You have guided and encouraged us to grow in our walk in faith so that we can express the goodness and the fullness of the Lord. You've challenged and encouraged us to deepen our connection with God, allowing us to experience His abundance, grace, and love. Your consistent guidance and unwavering commitment have had a profound impact on our church and the Charles County community. Pastor Brown and Lady Lorraine, your ministry has made a difference in our lives. Your unwavering kindness, the clarity of your teaching and preaching, the all-encompassing love you shared, and the strength of your faith have been immeasurable blessings. It has been clear that you lead with a heart devoted entirely to God and His people. We are grateful to have followed your leadership and guidance for these last 13 years. on behalf of the entire New Hope AME Church family and friends, we will forever cherish the memories, the love, the wisdom you've shared with us. We wish you both the very best in your next chapter of ministry. May God continue to bless you richly. All together, let us shout, New Hope! The Lord, we done. Thank you all. Thank you for your patience. We had to get through this, so thank you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, everybody. Praise the Lord. For this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you so much for each and every one of you who are here to celebrate with us. Thank you. It has been a journey, and I'm grateful for the journey. I want to take this opportunity. I know it's been extremely, we 2 hours in. But I thank God for the opportunity to have served as pastor of New Hope AME Church. I'm grateful for my family who have stood beside me, to my wife, to my children, Tiffany and Tierra. I honor you on today. For the many sacrifices that you have made. I'm grateful for you. And I just want, if you could just put your hands together for them. For the times that I had to go when you wanted me to stay, for times that I had to go when there were events that I could not attend. I thank you for allowing me the opportunity to serve the people. Anybody that knows me know that this is my first love. I love being a pastor. I love it. I love being a pastor, and I'm grateful that I've had an opportunity to serve the great people of New Hope. I said, God, I'm gonna try to get through this. I look out and I see people who have made a major impact on my life. I think about when I was sitting on a ministerial staff at Union Bethel AME Church, and Pastor Edna Jenkins allowed me the opportunity when she had a situation in her life. She reached out and she asked if I could come and preach the sermons at her church in her absence. That right there laid the foundation for me and helped build me in my pastoral ministry. So I honor you today, Pastor Jenkins. I honor you today, and I thank God that you are here. I thank God for Sister Pat Matthews, who is a major force in the AME Church. It has been a major blessing to me. I thank God for you. To Sister Jackie Picott, I honor you today. Sister Picott, when I was at DIA, she planted seeds in me. Planted seeds in so many young people. And she used to always tell me, you are special and you just continue to walk in the gift. I honor Sister Picott on today for just being a blessing to me. to, and I'm doing this out of order. I'm sorry. Stuff is coming. To the brothers at the lodge, I honor you today. Thank you for allowing me to be able to come and share a word with you. Thank you for taking me in as your own family. And brothers, I will be connecting with you real soon, if you know what I mean. God bless you. To the Honorable Arthur Ellis, to Reuben Collins, to Orlena, to Art Graves, to Jackie Roots, to Brother Kaiser, to Sister Radcliffe, to Carlicia and Cameron Ben, to Brother and Sister Bennett, and to the Stewart Board, and to the ministerial staff, I honor you. I thank you for the love that you have extended to me over the years, to me and Lorraine and the family. I honor you, and I thank you for your love and your support, and I'm just grateful. To my ICIG, the Intelligence Community Inspector General's Office, to all of you who thought it not robbery to take time out of your schedules to come and share with us on today, I thank God for you. To my supervisor, who is a direct report, he's an honorable himself, who is a direct report to the president, who thought it not robbery to come and share, to Brother Tom Monheim. Thank you, my brother, for being here. To the Thomases, to Paris, to Madison, to Joshua, to Bree, to Dana, I thank you for being more than just co-workers, colleagues. I thank you for being family. To Faith, thank you for being here and being a part of this. To Pastor Dutch and to Co-Pastor Dutch, thank you. I'm excited about the next chapter. Hallelujah. We will be talking. I'm excited about the next chapter. I have to say this. I want to honor my mother on today. I honor my mother on today because my mother, when we were young, my mother had to do it on her own for a long time. I saw the sacrifices, but me and Kip didn't really understand the magnitude of the sacrifice. It is nothing like the love of a mother. And even when we were being knuckleheads, she would take us and make us go to church. And little did I know when I would have to fight her because I did not want to do the Easter play.
Lord have mercy.
Oh, y'all see me with my Easter suit on, right? My Easter play suit. And she would tell us, you're going to do it anyway. Little did I know that I would go from being a young boy who did not want to speak in front of crowds to not being able to get a mic out of my hand. I honor you today, Mom, because I've realized the sacrifices you've made, and I thank God for you. I thank God for what you have instilled in me and Kip, and Lord knows, we appreciate you more than I think you know. So we honor you today. To my grandmother, not too many 55-year-olds can say that they still have their grandmother. And I'm grateful that she is still here with us. I'm grateful for all that she has done. When my mom would be working, she took care of me and Kip. And I'm grateful for all that you have done and all that you continue to do. To Perry, my second mom, I thank God for you who have constantly prayed for me and Lorraine and have constantly been a voice of reason. I honor you on today, and I thank you for being here on my special day. To my family, if my family could just stand, to all of my family, I'm just grateful. I'm grateful. Thank you for allowing me to be me and loving on me and just all of the sacrifices that you have made. I honor you today. Thank you. I'm grateful to have Sister Nell Hayes, who I just thank you for being here with me on today. Y'all, I'm just grateful today. Lord, have mercy. And I said, don't start calling names because you can't get everybody in. But I am. My heart is filled with joy today, more than you would ever know. I'm filled with joy. When I look out and I see the faces in this congregation, I see the people who have lost loved ones. I see the people who have struggled through difficulties. I see the people who have, we've cried together, we've laughed together, we've fussed and fought, but we, one thing I can say is that we're family. To the Union Bethel family, I see you and thank you for being here with me. I want to take this opportunity, Marquita and Todd, and thank you. I want to take this opportunity to thank, I'm telling you, Brother Lionel, I met him at the ODNI. And little did I know that we would become brothers, but to not only brothers, but true family. And I'm grateful that his mother and father came to share this day with me. I honor you today. So to everybody, thank you for the privilege of allowing me to serve as your pastor. Every time someone joins this church, I say to them, I am honored to be your pastor. And I truly mean it. I am honored to be the pastor of New Hope. But what I do know is that the best is still yet to come. The best is yet to come. And so thank you again for being here. Thank you for sharing the love. New Hope, it's been a ride, but it's been a good ride. Amen. It's been a ride, but a good ride. God bless you and thank you.
Amen, amen, amen. Lord, have mercy. I'm going to take 2 seconds. And I'm going to thank Pastor Brown myself. He and I spent a whole lot of nights in the hallways waiting on Reverend C. Wright and Reverend Braxton. Back in the time when we were armor bearers and we were walking with them. Lord knows we spent a long time with them. And for me to land here after I made my decision to step down and for you to allow me to come and heal, I am thankful, my friend. Forever. Love you, man. Now we're going to move on with church. Amen. I'll tell you what, Lord God has been so good to each of us. I got Kayla. Kayla Almond is going to come and lift a song for us. And then I'm going to come back and call for our offering, and we'll have a sermonic selection. And then we will have the preach word of God by the pastor, the Reverend Dr. Derek Nathan Brown. The Lord's name be praised.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. For God is good and he is worthy to be praised. Amen. I just want to say a quick little thing and then I'll sing. I just wanted to say thank you to my pastor and thank you to my first lady. My mom literally said this not too long ago. I came into this church as a youngin', you know, a little baby. I mean, I'm still a little young and all that stuff. But I came in and this is where I learned about my anointing, about the call that God has placed on my life and how I was able to just learn how to sing and able to walk in my faith. And for that, I just say thank y'all. I thank y'all for being my first lady and my pastor. I thank y'all for being my aunt and my uncle. I thank y'all for being my cheerleaders. And when I'm wrong at times, I thank y'all for calling me out. Amen. So I just want to say thank you for that. And I also wanted to share a story. Many of y'all might know that a couple days ago there was an earthquake, right, that shook, you know, the world. And I was in my room at school, and I was listening to a song, right? And as I was listening to the song, I was just worshiping God, and I was thanking God. And the song had just ended, and my roommate was like, Kayla, did you feel that? I said, feel what? What happened? She said it was an earthquake. I said, girl, I ain't feel none of that. I was praising the God. I was praising God. And it's the word says he will protect you in times of trouble. So I didn't even feel the earthquake. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And the song I was listening to is I Won't Complain. So that's the song that God told me to lift up at this time. So bear with me, y'all. I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days. Some sleepless nights, but when I look around and I think things over, all of my good days outweigh my bad days. So I won't complain. Although the clouds hang low and I can hardly see the road, I ask the question, Lord, why so much pain? But he I won't complain. Yes, he dried your tears away. You was about to cry and he dried your tears away. And he's turned my midnight into day. So I just say, thank you, Lord. 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 I won't complain. I won't complain. Even when I feel like what I want is different from what I need, I won't complain. I won't complain. 'Cause God, he's been good to me. He's been better to me than I could ever be to myself. He's been good to me. More than this old crooked world could ever be. He's been good. He's been good to me. My midnight into day. So I'll just say, can we just say thank you, Lord? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He's been so good. And thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
But God, God has been good to me. Has he been good to anybody? Has he been good to you? He's been better to me than I could ever be to myself. So I'll just say, thank you, Lord. Lord, I won't complain.
My. If that's your testimony this morning, that you won't complain, why don't you stand all over the house of God and give him some praise? Because I don't know about you, but when I look back at the things that I've been through, I won't complain. Thank you, Kayla. Thank you, Kayla, for allowing God to use you as he does. Hallelujah. It's our young people, y'all. She came all the way home from school. I believe she's at Temple to come and be with us today and to sing her heart out. Hey, that's anointing. God is working on her. There's no question in my mind. Thank you, sis. Thank you. It's offering time, beloved. It's offering time, beloved. We won't take you long, But I ask that you would prepare your offering. If you're going to donate the old-fashioned way with cash or a check, get it right. And then if you're going to do it electronically, remember we're on Cash App, and our Cash App address is $NewHope, AME Waldorf. Again, electronically on Cash App, the address is $NewHope, AME Waldorf. Please make sure you get that right, because somebody else got an offering before and they won't return it. That's a true story. I've been there, done that, and they've done that here too. So again, let's have our offering. If you will, hold your offering above your head and let us pray. Oh God in glory, once again, we come before you. It's offering time. I ask you right now, God, that you would take these offerings that your people are bring up, Lord God. We ask that you would bless the households and the budgets from which they come. We ask you, Lord God, that you would take these offerings and use them to your will, honor, and to your glory. And the people of God said, amen. Our ushers will come. We'll get a little sound going on, and let's have our offering. Amen.
Me doubt it. You can't make me doubt it in my heart. love of Jesus. I got the love of Jesus.
Things come of Thee, O Lord.
All things come of Thee, O Lord, and of Thine own have we give of Thee. Amen.
Amen, amen. As you take your seat, and we prepare for the sermonic selection, I'm going to ask the trustees if y'all could call some carpenters, because I think I had a feeling we need some help in here after this today, because we're going to tear this place up. We're going to tear this church on up. So the sermonic selection, and then we should hear the preach word of my brother, my friend, my pastor, the Reverend Dr. Derek Nathan Brown. The Lord's name be praised.
Pastor Brown, God bless you, my friend. Thank you for all the good times, all the shouts, all the praises. Amen. All the great times we had. And New Hope, we're going to still be here. We're going to help. We're going to do whatever we can to move on. But I want to let you know that the last time the door closed in my face, I turned around and saw an open door. So I want to let you know that when you walk out this place, one door will close. But my God, if you just keep on living, an open door. I dare y'all look at somebody right and just say, an open door is on the way. Good God. Hallelujah. So I just want to leave you with this song. It just says, may your struggles keep you near the cross. And may your troubles show you that you need God. And may your bad days, may your battles end the way they should. And may your bad days prove that God is good. And may your whole life prove that. What y'all gonna say? God is good. So may your struggles keep you near the cross. And may your troubles show you that you need God. And may your battles in the way they should, and may your bad days prove that God is, and may your whole life prove that God is. God has smiled on me. He has set me. Thank you.
yes, yes. He's been good to me. Oh, God has smiled on me. So may your struggles keep you near the cross, and may your troubles show you that you need God, and may your battles, may they in the way they should, and may your bad days, only Lady Lorraine, may your bad days, children, may your bad days, mama and grandmama, may your bad days prove that God is good, and may your whole life prove that. Come on, help me, everybody. God is good.
Come on, is there anybody in the house that know that God is good? Is there anybody in the house that know that God is good? Not because I've asked the question, but because you know that if it had not been for the Lord on your side, you would have gone crazy a long time ago. But for the grace of God, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. My, my, my. Come on, tell your neighbor God is good. That's the wrong neighbor. Look at somebody else and tell them God is good. Amen. Amen. And amen. Hallelujah. We bless God on today for what our eyes have seen and what our ears have heard. As I was sitting there reflecting, I thought and I forgot. To all of the people who are watching online, thank you for joining us. To all that are in the overflow room, thank you. And I want to give a shout out to my special friend, who is a brother to me, to Will Thomas, who even when I had my first pastoral assignment and would drive all the way to Frederick, he and his mama and his family would come all the way from down here to Frederick, Maryland, to be with me. To Will, to Sister Darlene, to the entire family, I love you. I know you in the overflow room. I love you. Amen. Again, to my cousin Angelina. Oh, my God. To Angelina for being with me today. I honor you. Thank you for being here. To Tony, thank you for being here. To my good friend and my sister, Lisa Stidham, thank you for being here. I love you. I love you. To Tracy, to Kayla, to Andrew, to Mike, I love you. And to my New Hope family, I love you. To Brother Phil, thank you. To Twink, I love you. Thank you. Thank y'all. We've had a long service. And so we're going to give you a quick word. But somebody say, he always says that. I want to call your attention to Mark chapter 4, Mark chapter 4, verse 31. Well, we'll start at the 35th verse. That's Mark chapter 4, starting at the 35th verse. I see you, Brother Sean said, take your time. Mark chapter 4, the 35th verse. And if we can stand all over the church, if you get it on your iPad, on your cell phone, can I tell you now is not the time to be. I know we're dressed up and all of that, but I believe that God has given me a word to share with you on today. And so we're going to, amen, now is not the, look, we're going to have an undignified kind of praise. Mark chapter 4, starting at the 35th verse, and the word of God reads as follows. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, let's go to the other side. Somebody say other side. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There was also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. God help me, Jesus. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, teacher, don't you care if we drown? He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? They were terrified and asked each other, who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. My brothers and sisters, as you take your seats, pray with me as I preach from the subject on the other side of this. On the other side of this, let us look to the Lord in prayer. Eternal and all-wise God, we humbly bow before you this day. We thank you, God, for your grace, your mercy, and your loving kindness. For God, this is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. God, speak right now in the name of Jesus. For God, yes, people came to honor the work that has been here. But God, we do not want people leave out of here, not saved, not filled with the Holy Ghost. It is our prayer that people will be encouraged, inspired, that they will be changed in a positive way. And so speak through me, God, that your people will be blessed. God, I pray right now that you would hide me behind the cross. And God, that in all that I do today, that you will get the honor, the glory, and the praise. Let everybody in the house say amen, 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 and amen on the other side of this. My brothers and sisters, as I come on this Sunday, I come to, yes, my last Sunday here preaching as the pastor of New Hope. But what I do also understand is that there is greater to come. My brothers and sisters, as I stand, all of us in here is going through a this situation. Either you are in something, you have come out of something, or you're about to go in. And if you are so holy enough that you are untouchable and you will not experience any trials, tribulations, obstacles in your life, then this sermon ain't for you. But I came for everybody today on this Sunday afternoon that don't mind saying, Pastor, I know I look good. I even smell good. But Pastor, I got some stuff going on in my life that would make the average person go crazy. But I am one who have not lost my praise. I still got my praise. I still got my sanity. I still got my hope. I still got my belief. Come on, is there anybody in the house that don't mind saying, I know I got some trouble, but I also got Jesus. I know I got some trials, but I also got Jesus. I believe, my brothers and sisters, that all of us up in here has encountered the possibility of defeat. And what I have learned is that the enemy desires to utilize the spirit of defeat to bring about doubt in your spirit. He tries to manipulate our faith by making our situation seem bigger than the God we serve.
But I came to put notice on the enemy today, to let him know that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue that rises up against you in judgment shall be condemned. I came to tell somebody, as I encourage myself, that there is the other side to this. The key word is this. Because your this isn't my this. And my this isn't your this. But we all got a this. I'm telling you, we all got a this that we have to deal with and that we have to go through. And I would say to you that we're not going to allow ourselves to let the this destroy us. I refuse to allow a circumstance to take me out. I refuse to allow a circumstance to waver my faith. But I receive and I believe that I'm going to stand, hallelujah, because I know that I am going to make it to the other side. They actually said to me, Pastor, what are you going to preach on your last Sunday? I said, I want to encourage some folk because I realize that every last one of us got something that we are facing in our lives that would take the average person out. But the fact that you are still standing and you are clothed and in your right mind is enough right there for you to give God some glory and give God some praise. Because if the devil could have had it his way, he would have taken you out. But you are still here. Come on and tell somebody, I'm still here. Can I tell you that the enemy specializes in the spirit of distractions? Preacher, what do you mean by the spirit of distractions? What the enemy wants to do is to distract you so bad that he takes you off course of being able to see the promise that God has for you. But don't you know everybody up in here has got a promise that God has given with your name on it? And sometimes the enemy will bring stuff your way to try to take you off track. But tell somebody, I'm staying the course. I'm not going to go off track. He specializes in the spirit of distractions. Why? Because he wants you to forfeit what God has for you before you can actually get to the promise. I oftentimes wonder, co-pastor, why do I go through the stuff that I go through? After all, I say and I cry before God and I tell him, I'm a good man. I'm a good husband. I'm a good father. I'm good to folk. Why do I go through what I go through? But what I realized that I had to learn is that when you got a promise that God has given with your name on it, that the purpose of the enemy is to try to take you off track. But I'm so glad that in the midst of my trials, that I still trusted God. In the midst of my obstacles, I still kept my eyes on Jesus. Is there anybody up in here that know what I'm talking about? I've had to learn that if I was not a distraction to the enemy, that he would leave me alone. But because I'm a child of the King, and I got a promise with my name on it, the devil can't help but try to destroy what God has. But how many of you know that the devil is a liar and the truth ain't in him? Can I tell you that he specializes and trying to get you to forfeit what it is that God has for you? I came to tell you this morning that the reason why you are going through what you go through is because, my God, God is trying to do something in you. What I have learned, God help me, Jesus, what I have learned is that if we can just keep the faith to hold on just a little while longer, that God will make a way somehow. When we look at our text, the Bible tells us in Mark chapter 4 that the disciples were in the boat and they were crossing to the other side. But the scripture tells us that a storm came up. And when I looked up, Sister Pam, the definition of a storm, definition of a storm is that there is a shift in the atmosphere. There is a destructive shift in the atmosphere that causes a disturbance in calmness and peace that is going on around you. And that's when the wind come, and that's when the waves come, and that's when the storm come. But how many of you know, my God, help me. How many of you know that God, even in the midst of a storm, that God is still able? The storm is a shift in the atmosphere that causes a disruption in the normal atmospheric calmness. And so each and every one of us have experienced a shift in the atmosphere. But what I came to tell you, and as I had to preach to myself, that storms may come, but they will not last. And if you just hold on to God's unchanging hand, God will make a way somehow. And I don't know about you, but every now and then I got to put the devil on notice to let him know that I've been in a storm, but baby, I'm still here. I've been in a storm, but I'm still standing. Is there anybody up in here that's got a I'm still standing kind of shout that the devil tried to take you out, but you're still here? Come on and tell somebody, I'm still here. I'm still here. I'm still here. The Bible says that the disciples, and this is what I love about the text, Sister Karen and Brother Wayne. This is what I love about the text. It tells us that the boat was on the making it cross into the other side. It says, look, that they took him along. And Jesus was in the boat. And it goes on to say that the storm came up, but that Jesus was in the stern sleeping. God, help me, Lord. And the thing that I love about this is that the disciples, you got to let the scripture speak to you. Pastor Hamlin, the disciples were used to being on a boat. They were used to being in on the sea. So they understood that sometimes waves would come and sometimes a storm would happen. But the Bible tells us that, my God, that they got afraid. Now, if I've been on the water before, why would I be afraid? Because I would expect to know what could potentially happen. But this right here is an illustration to me to remind me and you that even though, my God, that we are connected with Christ, there are going to be some things that will come our way that will rattle you and shake you to the core. But if you just hold on and hang in there, God will bring you out. Can I tell you, and I shared this with you before, that my God, that life has been good, but it also has brought me some difficult times. What I also know is that through all of my stuff, that God has continued to make a way. Don't you know that there are days when there are many expectations, obligations, aggravations, irritations, complications, observations, conversations, trepidations, trials, limitations, hospitalizations, miscommunications, misrepresentations, temptations. But through it all, God has kept me. And if God did it for me, he'll do it for you. Don't be weary in well doing. Just keep the faith and know that God is able. The Bible tells us that Jesus was on the boat. Preacher, what does this mean to me? Well, it tells me that even in the midst of our trials, even in the midst of our storms, that God is with us. I can tell you that in this congregation sits many people who have had sickness in their bodies, who have lost loved ones, who have been afraid, who have asked the question, God, why me? Who continues to say, God, please help me. And I want to encourage you today to think about the people on the boat, that even though they were afraid, God was with them. The Bible tells us that he was asleep in the stern. And so I asked myself as I read the text, Why is it that Jesus did not just, God, I feel like I want to run now. Why is it that Jesus did not just calm the water? Because he could have just calmed it even in his sleep. But I believe from the Gospel of Derek Brown that the reason why he did not calm the waves while he was asleep was because he had to allow the disciples to go through what they went through in order for them to be able to appreciate when they came out. Don't you know that many of us get to a place where we think our degree can do it, our money can do it, our status can do it, but don't you know the only one that can bring about the change in your life is the one that woke you up this morning and started you on your way? Too many of us want to take credit for what the Lord has done. But God will sometimes make you go through some stuff so when it's all said and done that you can't take credit for none of it. But all you can do is give credit to the Lord. Is there anybody that know what I'm talking about? That you've been through the fire, you've been through the flood, but you realize that it was only God that brought you out. Ah, God, I know that we're sanctified and dignified today, but I believe that we got to give credit where credit is due. God has done great things in our lives, and too oftentimes we underestimate and forget what he's done in our lives. The Bible says that he was sleeping in the stern, and the disciples woke him. Kayla, the reason why this blesses me is that some folk think the shout should come when he calmed the storm. God, I'm coming now. But can I tell you that your shout shouldn't come at the thought of thinking that he calmed the waves? Your shout should come at the fact that they had somebody they can call on. And so, my God, the Bible says, Sister Martha, that they called on his name. And some of us are going through some stuff right now, and you done called on everybody else. And God said, all I need you to do is to call me. Is to call my name. Is there anybody who knows the name above all names? His name is Jesus. The Bible says, Pastor Hamlin, that they called on him. And when they called on him, they woke him up. The other thing that that tells me is that you got to call the right one. And too many of us are blaming God for what God isn't doing in our lives, but you the one who's the problem because you calling on the wrong one. Stop asking Boo Boo the Fool to help you and do what only God can do. You got to call on his name. If it's healing, call on his name. If it's a breakthrough, call on his name. If it's turnaround, call on his name. If it's a family situation, call on his name. The Bible tells us that they called his name. And they said it woke him up. Now, this is where my shout comes. Because when I think about it, I said too many folk get in church and they get in their quiet place and they're too quiet. And so the Bible says you have to ask for what it is you want. And so the Bible tells us in this text that the disciples called on his name. And too many of us want to be sanctified, holy rollers, and so dignified that we don't call on his name. Now, you can sit up in here all you want and act like you got it together, but I need at least 75 of you that ain't ashamed. That's not ashamed. that's not ashamed to say, I'm fighting for my child. I'm fighting for my grandchild. I'm fighting for my sanity. I'm fighting for my health. I'm fighting. And tell them, I tell your neighbor right now, I know that we're sitting tight together. I know we're tight. And I know I got dressed up. But I got too much at stake. And this shout that I got, baby, it ain't about you. But it's about what I need God to do in my life. I got some demons on my job that I gotta get rid of. I got some demons in my house I gotta get rid of. I got some demons in my family I gotta get rid of. Is there anybody that know what I'm talking about? Say yeah. You want it. You gotta fight. You gotta fight to be able to get the attention. You gotta fight because sometimes we'll get so caught up in our stuff that we forget who to call on. Can I tell you that there are things that have happened around me and that's happening around me where I feel like God, I need you to help me. And God says to me, open up your mouth and tell me what you want. There's a song that says, call him up. Call him up. Tell him what you want. Is there anybody up in here that need God to do something in your life? Say yeah. Yeah. Y'all sit down. I'm almost done. The Bible says that they called on him. And when they called on him, it woke him up. And how many of you know that when you wake Jesus up and get his attention, that God can't help but respond? You gotta stop sitting back and trying to fix in the natural what can only be won in the spiritual. Y'all better make some room because I got to walk a pew. The Bible says we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against spiritual wickedness in high places. And so you got to stop trying to fight in the natural what can only be won in the spiritual. Can I get a witness? Hey, God. They said it woke. They woke him up. And when they woke him up, Jesus did something. Can I tell you that anytime you get his attention, he's got to respond. Anytime you get his attention, he's got to respond. But can I tell you that he doesn't always respond the way we want him to?
Oh, that's the tension.
And yes, that has been a challenge of mine, that God doesn't always respond the way I want him to. But what I do know is that God's got my best interest at heart. And I have been learning over the course of the past few years of the scripture that says, touch not thou anointed one, and do thy prophet no harm. I have been lied on. I have been talked about. I have been mistreated. I have been tossed aside, but through it all, God has been faithful. I felt like I wanted to give up, but I stayed in the boat. I did not get off. Somebody needs to know that you gotta stay in the boat. The Bible in the text, it did not say that they got off the boat. The boat had waves coming up against it, almost took the boat out. But if you, let the text speak to you. It says that my God, that the disciples, Rodney, stayed in the boat. And too many of us want to get out of the boat when God says, stay in the boat. I dare you to stay in the boat. Stay in the boat. You gotta stay in the boat. Come on, tell your neighbor, stay in the boat. Stay in the boat. Don't get out. You gotta stay in the boat. If you get out of the boat, you will drown. But if you stay in the boat, everything will be all right. Say yeah. Madison, stay in the boat. Tell them I'ma stay in the boat. I'ma stay in the boat. The waves are coming, but I'ma stay in the boat. I wanna jump off, but I'ma stay in the boat. Somebody hand me my phone. I'ma stay in the boat. And because they stayed in the boat and got Jesus' attention, he got up. And when he woke up, Bonnie, he got up and said to the waves, quiet. Quiet. Be still. Don't you know that God, when he speaks, even the winds have to obey him? So if the winds gotta obey him, what do you think he'll do to the person that's trying to do you wrong? I was so blessed this week. I was getting my hair cut yesterday, and a thing text popped into my Facebook. I thought I saw the brother here, Dana Lewis. Brother Lewis sent something in Facebook that blessed my soul. I said, Lord, in spite of all of what's going on around me, I looked at the Facebook post, and in the Facebook post, it reminded me that what you say out of your mouth. The Bible says that there's life and death in the power of the tongue. In the post, it says that there is power in the say. Come on, somebody tell somebody, say the right thing. You better say the right thing. There is power in the say. When you say I'm strong, strength will come. When you say I'm healed, healing will come. When you say it's gonna turn around will come. When you say you're not broke, your finances will be all right. You may not have everything you want, but you got everything that you need. Anybody, everybody, say yeah. The power, Marquita, is in the say. You don't say what you have. You have to have what you say. So stop saying I'm sick. Stop saying that I'm broke. Stop saying that I'm a nobody. Stop saying and something about your children. Lord, I had to learn now, and I'm getting ready to preach about myself. I can hear my kids now saying, Dad, don't tell it all. I would complain and talk about my kids and say, God, they're not doing what I want them to do. They're turning right, left when I want them to go right. They didn't go to the school I wanted them to go to. They didn't do this. They didn't do that. And I focused so much on what they didn't do that I lost focus on what they were doing. And when I stop, but when I stopped to think about what they were doing, God made away from me when I thought about what the Lord was doing in their lives. All kinds of doors started opening. The power is in the say. So what you gonna say? I dare you to say, I'm healed. I dare you to say, I'm more than a conqueror. I dare you to say that doors are opening. I dare you to say that my child is healed. I dare you to say that my body is healed. I dare you to say that I got a sound mind. The power is in the say. So what you gonna say? What you gonna say? What you gonna say? I'm gonna speak healing over my family, healing over my life, healing over my circumstance. God, if my leg wasn't acting up, I would shout right now. God, I'm telling you. So I need somebody to shout for me. That you will. Hey, God, come on, somebody. Told it to be quiet. Some of you have been trying to speak to the storm yourself. Let God speak to the storm. God, I'm telling you, if you turn it over to the Lord, everything will be all right. He might not work it the way you want it worked, but it will be all right. Is there anybody up in here that's got a made up mind that you're gonna turn it over to the Lord and that you recognize you don't know how he's gonna do it? You don't know when he's gonna do it, but you know it's already done. And if you believe that it's already done, put a shout on it right now. Says that after he said be quiet and be still, that the winds died down and it was completely calm. It went on to say that Jesus asked his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you not have faith? These were people that walked with Jesus. So this actually encourages me, because it lets me know that even though I know God, and even though I have a relationship with God, that there are gonna be situations and circumstances that come in my life that will cause me to have my faith shaken and rattled. But I came to tell somebody today that I'm gonna keep my foot locked solid on my faith. Now, can I tell y'all this? I don't know a lot about sports, but I do know in basketball that once you get the ball, that you got the ball in your hand. God, where's the coach? Coach Paris, help me if I'm wrong. But when you get the ball in your hand, and once you get the ball in your hand, you can't take two steps. You can only use one foot, right, before you shoot the ball. And so one foot, God, Dutch, I feel like running. One foot's got to stay planted. One foot's got to stay planted in space in order for you to throw the ball and shoot without being told that you're traveling. Did I get it right? And so what God told me to share with y'all today is that too many of us are traveling through our stuff instead of keeping one foot planted. Planted on the solid rock. Is there anybody that know what I'm I tell you that in order to get the promise that God has, because the Bible said that they were trying to get to the other side. But what this tells me, y'all, is that when you're crossing to the other side, that there will be storms that will come. But it's all in how you handle the storm that will determine whether or not you get to the other side. If they had jumped off the boat, some of them would have drowned. If they had jumped or given up and lost true hope and not called on God, their situation could have been differently. But because they stayed in the boat and they trusted the process, New Hope, I've told you before that the devil can't mess with the promise, but he'll try to get you in the process. Because if he can mess with the process, if he can mess with you during the process, then he's got you, because it could potentially cause you to forfeit the promise. But I want to know if there's anyone up in here that's going to hold on to the promise that God's got with your name on it. Can I tell you that getting the promise without the process is like building a house without a foundation? You've got to stand and understand that you've got to make it through the process. This is for everybody that's going through a struggle right now. You might be saying, God, why me? And I always say, I don't know the answer to the why, but I do know that God is faithful. I want to encourage you, because the process is not there to destroy you. But what I've learned, Reverend, is that the process is there to develop you. I am not the same person I was 13 years ago because of the process. I'm not the same person I was a month ago because of the process. You've got to trust the process. And you might be saying, well, that's just one illustration of God moving and making it so that somebody could get to the other side. But, Reverend, I believe that on the other side is a promise with your name on it. And the reason why I know that I'm going to make it to the other side is because Sarah made it on the other side of not being able to have a baby. Joseph found himself on the other side of the pit. The Israelites made it on the other side of the Red Sea. Noah made it on the other side of the flood. Daniel made it on the other side of the lion's den. Moses made it on the other side of the Nile. Rahab made it on the other side of Jericho. David made it to the other side of his fight with Goliath. Job made it to the other side of his faith test. The woman made it to the other side of her sickness. Jairus made it in the other side of his daughter's illness. The deaf man made it on the other side of his hearing loss. The paraplegic made it on the other side of the mat. Peter made it on the other side of denial. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego made it on the other side of the fiery furnace. Paul made it on the other side of the struggle. But that's just an encouragement. The reason why I shout and know I'm going to make it to the other side is because they hung him high. They stretched him wide. He hung his head. And then he died. But the Bible says that on the third day, got up with all power in his hands. And because he got up, he made it to the other side. Come on and tell your neighbor, you gonna make it to the other side. You gonna make it to the other side. Everything is gonna be all right. Say yeah. People have been saying, aren't you tired? Aren't you scared? Aren't you this? Aren't you that? I said, baby, I'm gonna make it to the other side. And you heard what I just said. I said, I'm going to make it to the other side. In other words, I ain't on the other side yet, but I got enough faith to know that I'm going to make it to the other side. Is there anybody up in here that's got enough faith to know you're going to make it to the other side? Say yeah. I'm going to make it to the other side. I'm going to make it to the other side. Come on, take somebody, tell them you're going to make it. You're going to make it. You're going to make it to the other side.
Yeah, I'm going to make it.
You're going to make it to the other side. Ah. Fladrika, I said I'm going to make it to the other side. And can you do me one more favor? Give me my phone. Y'all got to. I used to say, take a picture so that the devil can see where you were at this point. But what I realized is that when you take a picture, that snaps the moment in time. And so I don't want the devil to be able to see that moment. That one moment don't define what God is going to do in my life. And so now I take a video. Come on, y'all. To let the devil know that what you see today, you might not see tomorrow. Because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Somebody say yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Can I tell you, can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Can't nobody do me like the Lord. There's a man in this church by the name, hallelujah, of Al Hammack, that I would hear him singing in the halls of this church. God, I'm telling you, and I would be sitting in my office, and I could hear this voice saying, there's a storm out over the ocean, and it's moving
well
this old way.
Yeah.
If your soul's not anchored in Jesus,
yeah, Lord,
it will surely drift away. Let your soul be anchored in the Lord and know that you are gonna make it to the other side.
I know that I can make it.
Yeah.
I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way. Come on, church. My life is in his hand. With Jesus, I can take it. With Jesus, I can take it. I know. I know.
Hallelujah. What God has for me, it is for me. What God has for me, it is for me. I know without a doubt, I know without a doubt that He will bring me out. What God has for me, what God has for me.
Like
what God has for me, it is for me. Oh, what God has for me, it is for me. Oh, I know without a doubt that He will bring me out. What God has for me, it is for me.
Amen, amen. Ain't God good? What a mighty word. What a mighty word on this morning. Thank you, Pastor. Well, beloved, as we march on into almost our fourth hour, it is communion time. Amen. But before we do any of that, I'm getting a little out of order. After a powerful service like we've had this morning, is there anyone here that has never given their life to the Lord? Is there anyone here that doesn't understand what the pastor was talking about getting to the other side of this? And that having God in your life and trusting Him that no matter what's going on, that He will see you through. Is there anybody in the house this morning that has never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior? Is there one? Is there one? Come on, make your way to the altar. We got plenty of time to do God's work. We can't rush what we're going to do for God. Is there anybody in the house this morning that has never given their life to the Lord? Is there anybody here this morning that's searching for a church home, a place where they can receive the word of God and direction as they seek out soul salvation? Is there one this morning? Is there one? Amen. 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 Let us prepare for communion. Amen. Can we get the stewardesses to come and uncover the table for us now? Make your way, make your way. Make your way, make your way. Come, beloved. Let us go.
Praise the Lord. And as they are uncovering the table, the solicitation says, you that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor, intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in His holy ways. Draw near with faith and take
this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God by meekly kneeling. I'm going to ask that my cousin join me. Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ,
maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins of wickedness, which me from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed.
It's your divine majesty, provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto you, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
It is very meet, right, and our bounding duty that we shall at all times and in all places give thanks unto you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your holy name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. Amen.
We do not presume to come to this your table, O Lord, trusting in your own righteousness, but you and your manifold and great mercies. We are so much worthy as to gather the crumbs under this your table. But you are the same Lord whose property is to always have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful souls and bodies may be made clean by his death and washed through his blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your tender mercy did give your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech you, and grant that we, receiving these your creatures of bread and wine, according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink all of it, for this is my blood for the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this and as often as you shall drink it in remembrance of me. My brothers and sisters, and let us open up to the wafer.
Let us take it and let us break it together. My brothers and sisters, let us now eat it together. The song says, what can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let us now take the cup and drink the wine that represents the blood that Jesus shed on Calvary for your sins and mine. My brothers and my sisters, you've now renewed your spiritual covenant with Christ. Feast on it in your hearts until his coming again.
And they went down from the Mount of Olives and sung a hymn, I Know It Was the Blood.
I know it was the blood.
I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died.
Amen, amen, and amen. As they cover the table, my brothers and sisters, you have made my day last Sunday here as the pastor a great one. Thank you so much for coming out and being a part of it and making this day so special. I love each and every one of you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Amen, amen. To all that are watching online, thank you so much. I see your comments. And Lorraine and I send love right back to you. To those that are in the overflow room, thank you so much. I want, and I know it's been a long day, and so I thank you for taking the time out. But if my family and my ICIG family and anybody else who wants to take some photos while I have my brother here, I want to take some photos so that I can look back on this moment and remember this day. And remember each and every one of you being a part of this day. Again, I thank all of you. I totally forgot in all of my comments that I forgot someone that has just been my right hand. I want to take this opportunity to acknowledge my brother and my sister-in-law and my little nephew. To my brother Kip, come on, man, stand up. Let them see you. To my brother Kip and my sister-in-law, to my cousin Wanda, to my family, God, man, I tell you, I'm just dusty to everybody that's here. I'm overwhelmed. Anita, thank you to you and David for coming, and to this choir, to everybody. I am truly a blessed brother, and when I say I'm going to miss being the pastor of New Hope, but I'm excited that I'm making it to the other side to see what the other side holds. So let us stand as we prepare to be dismissed. Because we kept you so long, we do have some light refreshments, so please take advantage of it. In fact, let me bless the food. Lord, thank you for the food that has been prepared. Help bless the hands that have prepared it. Help it be nourished into our bodies in all the right ways. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen and amen. Amen. And I'm just going to say the prayer and we're going to close it out. Let us bow. Eternal and all-wise God, again, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this moment. God, it's been 13 years as pastor of New Hope AME Church. God, Lorraine and the girls and I have loved every bit of it. And we realize, God, that even though the journey has not always been easy, what we can say is that you carried us through. And God, we thank you for the fruits of the labor. Oh, God, I pray supernatural blessings and miracles over everybody under the sound of my voice. I pray for the next pastor that shall come through this door. I pray, God, that you will allow them to take the ministry to even higher heights. And, oh, God, let my church family know that I will always love them and that they will always be a part of me and Lorraine's lives. God, we love you, we honor you, and we adore you. And as we leave this place, God, again, we pray blessings over each and every person that's here. And now unto him who's able to keep all of us up in here from falling, and to the only God who's able to present us faultless before his throne with exceedingly great joy, be all honor, glory, dominion, and power, henceforth, now, and forevermore. Let all of God's people say, amen, 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 and amen. Come on and hug somebody and tell them that you love them.